Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jadrow, the Director of Portfolio Management at TRICOM. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, TRICOM was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenter today is Amy Monroe, owner of Staffing eTrainer and an experienced speaker for the staffing industry. Amy engages with a variety of staffing firms nationwide to help accelerate the time to full productivity for new hires, as well as enhance the skills of tenured staff. The practical and applicable ideas Amy shares in her training sessions, combined with her 30 years of industry experiences and adult learning techniques. Amy has shared her talents, philosophies, and techniques with many staffing organizations. A few of those associations are the Ohio Staffing and Search Association, Massachusetts Staffing Association, American Staffing Association, National Association of Personnel Services, Jersey Staffing Alliance, and South Carolina Association of Staffing Professionals. Outside of work, Amy enjoys playing tennis and spending time with her family. She also volunteers her talent development skills with an international collegiate organization and is passionate about teaching women's leadership skills to collegiate women and their volunteer partners. Staffing eTrainer helps companies focus on their greatest assets, their internal team. Your employees are major contributors to the worth and profit of the organization. For Staffing eTrainer, helping people gain new skills and knowledge is a passion. With 30 years of industry experience and proven learning techniques to strengthen the productivity, knowledge, and performance of your team. Struggling to find internal talent, demanding customers, and mounting frustration? Do any of these sound familiar to you? The current labor market is not going to change much, so we need to find a way to overcome these challenges. In today's Industry Insider webinar, we'll provide insights on how to solidify your employee-employer relationship and safeguard the clients that you want to keep. Loyalty will create the bond that will help you succeed in today's market. However, loyalty is easy to say but hard to create. Amy with Staffing eTrainer will help you determine the best questions to ask your clients, companies, and talents, understand the phase of the relationship you have with each client, and craft a magical value proposition for your team and focus on the client of choice for the strongest loyalty. In our time together, you will learn the magic of understanding the relationship phases to keep loyalty strong, gathering quality feedback to gauge service impact and improve loyalty, crafting and delivering a strong value proposition and engagement for your internal team. Determining your client of choice will create the strongest partnerships and loyalty. By the end of this session, you will know why loyalty is the magic word. If you have any questions during today's presentation, please utilize the chat feature and be sure to send your question to all so that we can address your questions for you. And with that, I will turn the floor over to Amy.
Thank you so much, Amanda. I appreciate that. Quite the introduction. Thank you. And I am excited to be here. I want to thank Amanda and TRICOM for inviting me to spend time with your customers and your friends. I appreciate it wholeheartedly. And thank you very much for that. As Amanda says, I am Amy, and I've been in the industry for over 30 years, and I'm going to take what I've learned from my clients, which are clients of all different sizes and nationwide. And I'm going to offer some information for you all that might help you and will help you create loyalty. If you'd like a copy of today's presentation, I am going to be sharing a lot of example questions, a lot of steps and that kind of thing. I'm more than happy to share it with you. So if you'd like a copy of the presentation, feel free just to email me and I will pass that along to you. So for today's agenda, we're going to cover three areas. We're going to cover the current employment market and actually future employment market. We're going to talk about these five phases of the relationship. And we're going to talk about creating loyalty and what's the magic to doing that. So before we start, I want to share about, I was talking to a friend of mine the other day. She's younger. She is a recruiter. She's fairly new in the industry. And she likes what she does. But in talking with her the other day, oh my gosh, she was frustrated. She said, Amy, I'm reaching out to all these people. I'm trying to leave these messages and I'm trying to get interviews set up and I'm trying to get placements. And she said, it's just not happening. And she was so, so frustrated. And one area that she was frustrated with is she wasn't getting guidance, right? Nobody was telling her what to do to be successful. So, of course, I helped her with being that is what I do. So I helped her through that. And, you know, thank goodness she was able to get some interviews and make some placements and she's on a better way. But I want us to be mindful of today's talent. We're struggling, frustrated. We've got these orders. We can't fill them. We can't find people. We've got to figure out a way to engage our team and create loyalty, even in times of frustration. So that's my hope today. I want to ask you a question before we get started. I want you just to think about for a moment a particular business that you are very loyal to. You guys, this is going to be interactive, so I want you to go ahead and open up your chat panel. The option for me to do that is in the bottom right of my screen, but you should have a button to open up the chat panel. Please do that. I want to hear from you. So think of a business that you're very loyal to. You know, it could be a dry cleaners, it could be a restaurant, a store, maybe a particular brand. I want to know, why are you loyal to them? What makes you loyal to them? And I want you to type your answers in chat. I'll get you started. I have a particular business that I'm very loyal to because every time I walk in the door, they know my name. They're very, very friendly. They go above and beyond in order for us to create that relationship and in order for me to feel comfortable. I love that. I have a dry cleaners. I hate shopping. I loathe shopping. So I just go out and buy really good clothes and I take them to a dry cleaner and hope to keep them as nice as I can for as long as I can. I have a dry cleaner. I know they're going to do what they say they're going to do. So I would love to know in chat, why are you loyal to a business? What are the traits that keep you loyal? And if you guys will chat to everyone, that would be great. We can all see it. And Amanda, I'm not sure if somebody has chatted specifically to panelists or to yourself, and if there's some we're missing. But I'd love for you guys to chat in. Everybody seems to be a little shy today. But if you would do that, that would be fantastic. I want you to think about this from another perspective also. Think about personal relationships. So think about your best friends, right? Think about your coworkers. Think about your spouse, your significant other. Why are you loyal to them? What is it that makes you loyal to your personal relationships? So I like it, Carrie. So immediate human responsiveness. Oh my gosh, yes. Trying to get a human on the telephone now is enough to drive you crazy, isn't it? I love that local restaurants. They're in my hometown. I want to support my community. Absolutely. You feel like you're giving back to the local community. You trust the people. Oh my, that's huge, right? So I want you to be keeping that in mind as we go through our session today. I want you to think, why am I loyal to someone else? Because I'm going to ask you a question in a minute about why people are loyal to you. So there is this very popular ebook going around with staffing companies. And if you guys have not seen this, I would absolutely suggest that you go download it. It's called The Demographic Drought, and it's from MC. And they basically analyze market trends, a lot of workforce trends. They've been doing this since 2001. And this report is all about what they're calling the sans-demic, which is without people. I think every one of us knows that. I do have the link for the ebook on the bottom of this slide. If you want to do a quick screen capture and grab that so you'll have it. But I want to share some information with you. Some of this we know. These are facts that we know today, right? Unemployment's low. Our hourly rates are having to increase. The employees are expecting and they're in the driving seat now, right? So they can demand that. Recruiters are frustrated and failing, like my friend. Even to the point that my friend is feeling guilt. She is guilty and feeling guilty she's not making placements and that she's letting her company down. So there's a lot more than just frustration, right? There's guilt in there as well. Here's some things I don't know if you know or not, but I wanted you to be aware of. 6 out of 10 adults that have children feel like COVID has negatively impacted their job or their career. And I know right now, I'm in Atlanta. I know right now in Atlanta, we've probably, most school systems are back. They're all in person. But now we're hearing all these schools that are going to virtual because of COVID cases. That's negatively impacting the workforce, right? Our participation rate in the workforce is 61.7%. That's not going to get any better. That's about where we are. For historical means, going back to 2001, I'm showing you this graph. It actually was at about 67% at one point, but it's going down. Just today, and I wanted to make sure I got this on the slide, so it looks kind of hokey on the right, but go with me. I was reading an article about, you know, this great resignation. We've all heard about this, how many people have left the workforce. And in May of this year, it was 3.6 million. And there are the reasons that are here on the screen. I don't have to read every bullet to you all, you're adults. But the reasons, we need to be aware of those and understand them. You know, they want flexibility. Well, guess what? We're staffing. We can offer that to our talent, right? Our temporary associates. They're just burned out. They're like my friend, working and working and working and feeling nothing from it. And a lot of them still want remote work. They had a taste of that. They were successful with it, and they still want remote work. So, and they want meaningful work. And you guys, somebody made a comment when I asked a question a minute ago about your loyalty. You want to feel like you're giving back and supporting your hometown. So do workers. They want to feel like they're doing something meaningful. But there's some stats I want to share with you that you may not be aware of, and these are things you should know for the future. This sans-demic is happening. We do have fewer people available than we have job openings. Most of you know there's probably 10 million, about 10 million job openings, and we only have 8.7 million unemployed people to fill those jobs. And that participation rate in the workforce, as I just said, is declining. So it's not like once unemployment ends, it's not like once COVID ends, it's going to get better, but we're still going to have to be fighting for talent. This isn't something that's going to be ending anytime soon. I actually saw something the other day that said by 2028, we were going to be short 6 million employees in the US workforce. So I want us to know that this is coming down the pike. So what I'm offering you today, I'm hoping I can help you be forward thinking and kind of get things in motion before it's too late, if you will. Some additional things about the future workforce. Boomers are leaving this workforce in great numbers. We all know that. The boomers are the most affluent generation. They can afford to leave the workforce earlier. And those remaining have a very, very different view of what work life looks like. I would love to hear in chat, if you guys are feeling any of this today, just give me a yes or an amen or whatever. How many of you are feeling this issue today, right now. The second to last bullet, you guys, was amazing to me when I read this in that ebook. The number of prime age men willingly opting for part-time work jumped from 6 million to 8 million in 2019. 8 million prime age men are saying, I'm just going to work part-time. I don't want to work full-time. And a lot of that is due to their parents can now financially support them, as well as it's a shift in demographics. Kids are going back to their home and living back home again, right? So, but 25 million 25 to 29 year olds live at home. So they don't have to have that paycheck, right? I remember when I got my apartment, I got out of college, I wanted to fend for myself, I wanted my own place. I had to have a job to pay for it. It's not so much like that anymore. It's a different environment out there. So I wanted you guys to be aware that this is happening and this isn't going to change. We're going to continue to have this struggle. On the company, that's on our talent side, right? Let's talk a little bit about your customers, because loyalty is on both sides of the coin. So on your customers, we have this partnership ladder Staffing eTrainer has developed. And over the years of dealing with hundreds of clients, we found out that there are basically kind of four types of partnerships that you all have with your clients. The first one is a vendor. Very, very transactional. They just call you when they need you, right? Very transactional. They sometimes don't give you heads up. They'll call you today at 3 and say, I need 10 people in the morning, right? That's a very vendor transaction oriented relationship. The next step up is a critical supplier. So as I'm saying this, think about your clients and where they would fall, y'all. So that was quite Southern, fall y'all. Well, I'm from Atlanta, so there you go. The next rung up is critical supplier. You're going to be their first call always. They rely on you and they'll give you advance notice. They know how to work with you and make it easy for you. And you're the first call. That's a critical supplier, right? The next is a partner. And this is where you really are starting to be a critical component to their success. This is where thought leadership comes in. I'm talking to them about trends in the workforce. I'm talking to them about trends in their industry. I'm helping them talk about growth projections. They're telling us their growth projections so we can be planning for the next quarter, 2 quarters, year, whatever it might be. This is a loyal customer who values you and your partnership. The last rung, very few of these, but the last rung are your strategic partners. And sorry, that graphic is a little bit off here with our integration. It's highly relational. Your strategic partner is highly relational. You actually have a seat at the workforce table. They're sitting you down and they're saying, this is what we're going to do. January of 2022, we are going to have an expanded facility. We're going to need to hire 100 people. I want you, staffing company, my supplier, I want you to go find out, will I be able to get 100 people in this market? What am I going to have to pay for those people? What is it going to look like from a retention standpoint? They come to you for the HR specifics. Loyalty with your customer actually rises as you rise on this ladder. So I wanted to give you a perspective of where's the talent market, what's happening today, what's happening in your own customers, and where might they be in the partnership relationship. What I want to talk with you now is thinking about talent and thinking about your clients. I want you to open up chat again. Why should they be loyal to you? Think about that. Why should your clients be loyal to you? Why should your internal talent, your internal employees, why should they be loyal to you? That's what we're going to talk about today. That's what I'm going to help you unravel If you don't know that answer, and I didn't see a lot of chats, so if you don't know that answer and put it in there one after another, we're going to help you get there. Okay? So, because we care about them is exactly right. That is one for sure. So, have you guys ever heard about this? Have you ever heard the saying, do what you did at the beginning of a relationship and there won't be an end? Right? So, I think about my husband and I when we dated. You know, when you first start dating, oh my gosh, I had all the makeup on. I was looking good. I was, you know, on my best behavior, minding my P's and Q's. I was really engaged with everything that he said. He was with me. You know, the first, you know, couple weeks, maybe month, you're still trying to impress the other person, right? But then you get into the relationship a little bit, and it might get down to month 3 or 6, and I think, oh, well, if I'm just going to his house for pizza and watch a movie, I don't need to put makeup on, right? I started getting a little relaxed in the relationship. Well, in our relationship, after about that point in time, we had a little bit of our first big fight. And I said, I'm out. Bye. I'm gone. And he came back. And he had 4 dozen roses, hid in my apartment, wooed me back, right? Went back through the whole process of strengthening the relationship. But what we learned was we weren't treating each other like we did at the beginning of the relationship. And it had faltered. And it had broken. So I want to talk to you about that. And I want to talk to you about these 5 phases of a relationship that Staffing E-Trainer put into place to help us understand how we interact and relate to clients. This is clients. As I'm saying this, you guys, I want you to be thinking of your internal team too, or your temporary associates. But this is for clients. So if we think about the phases we go through, it starts with the chase, right? We are showing our best self. We are interested. We're interactive. We're promising all these things that we can do, right? Then we move into the honeymoon phase. Everybody's happy. You know, I'm frequently visiting my client. I've got regular communication with them. They're the high priority. They're top priority. I'm on it. After a little bit of time, like my relationship with my husband, we become comfortable. Well, I really don't have to put on makeup. It's not quite like it used to be. Maybe I'm not communicating or visiting quite as often to that client. Maybe I have other new customers that are coming in and they're taking priority and I'm giving them the chase and the honeymoon, right? Everybody in the comfortable stage says, oh, it's fine. It's fine. That we're good. It's fine. We've worked with them a while. It's fine. But it's eventually going to move into that tolerance. And that's where we're starting to hear complaints on both sides. I wish I could see you guys right now because I'd love a show of hands of how many times do you hear this in your office? Oh no, it's that client again. What do they want? You take the call. I don't want to talk to them. Or, oh, it's that temporary? No, tell them I'll call them back, right? We're at the tolerance phase there. Very low priority. What this phase does actually, you guys, is it allows your client to go over and kind of open the door a little bit. Because when it comes to the decision phase, this is where we say, I'm out. I'm not happy. You're not happy. I'm disappointed. We're not getting the service we said we were getting. Now that open door, they're inviting vendors right on in that door and they're talking to vendors. They want to date somebody new. So I want you all to think about this realistically. So take out a piece of paper, just get a blank piece of paper. And I want you to draw this chart. So I want you to put 6 columns and I want you to do 6 rows. So I'll give you a minute, draw that out on a piece of paper, 6 columns, 6 rows. The top of the columns, I want the headings to be customer is in the first, and then the 5 phases, chase, honeymoon, comfortable, tolerance, decision. Now I want you also either keep that table going on down the page or create a new table. And this one is internal employee. Same thing, 6 columns, as many rows as you want there. The first column is internal employee. Now that we have those charts, this is what I want you to take. I'm going to give you a minute to do this. I want you to be brutally honest with yourself. Put a customer name down. And then mark Where are they in the relationship phase? Are they a new client, so they're in the chase? Are they fairly new, or you just work really well with them and they're in the honeymoon phase? Do you have some in the tolerance or decision phase? So if you write down your top five clients and note where they are, and I want you to do the same thing for your internal employees. If you are a staffing specialist, you might think about this for your temporary associates, right? But I want us to be brutally honest and brutally aware of where is my loyalty with these people? If you have somebody in the tolerance or the decision column, your loyalty is waning or could be gone, and we need to build it back. So how do we do that? What is that magic to create loyalty? Gosh, don't we wish that we had that little magic wand and would just say, be loyal to us, right? And that doesn't happen. So what we have to do is we have to create the loyalty. We have to determine what it is. And we're going to do that by using the acronym of MAGIC. So the first step in creating loyalty and understanding what loyalty is measuring your current satisfaction and the current value. So that's looking at your internal employees, that's looking at your clients and finding out, where are we today? Like, what does that actually look like? So open up chat. I want everybody to be on board with chat. And I'm going to ask you some questions, and I want you to write true or false or T or F. And please do this as I go through and ask these questions. So in chat, true or false, you know the value that your team members want and expect. Do you really know the value that your team members want and expect? Yes or no? I'll give you a minute to put that in chat so we can see what everyone's saying. Thank you for the honesty. Thank you, thank you. It's the only way we're going to get better. Thank you very much. Yep. Thank you. Okay, how about this next one? You could tell us what makes yours a better workplace than your competitor. Can you tell us what really makes your company a better workplace than your competitor? True or false? And the next question, you could articulate the value and emotional connection your team members would say they receive daily from their investment of time. So, could you articulate at the end of every day when your employees leave, could you articulate the value and the emotional connection that they received from the investment they made in your company? True or false? We are at a point in time that we have to change, or we're going to be struggling. I like that, false plus. We are going to be struggling, moving forward and trying to bring on board new talent. So that's why I want us to think about measuring, and how do we do that? Well, we do that by asking not just questions, but the right questions, okay? Really the right questions. So what does that mean? Have you guys ever heard or said this yourself, any of these questions when you're talking with the client? So have you ever said, hey, how's Jane doing? When you're talking to a client, or calling to say, hey, did Jim arrive okay this morning? How about, on a scale of 1 to 10, how would you rate us and why? Or how does your service meet our expectations? Have you heard this? Yes or no, right? Most people, these are common questions that are asked and that people hear in their companies, in staffing companies. I hear it all the time when I'm in staffing companies. How about these? Have you heard these questions said or have you asked them with your internal team? Do you feel we're giving you the support you need to do the best job you can do? Or maybe we ask them, you know, career-wise, where would you like to see yourself in 3 years? So maybe during your annual review, so these kind of questions that you ask. Maybe, hey, would you refer a friend to work at our company? Again, these are very common questions that I hear people ask. But my question to you is, if you think about it, are these relationship-changing questions? Meaning, the answer to that question, is it going to give you enough information that it would actually change the relationship? I would venture to say that probably not. I don't see those as relationship changing. So in order to figure out how to get loyalty and how to figure out what value, what are the needs that my internal team or my clients want, you need to be asking the right questions. So before I give you this list of questions, I just want to give you this quick tip. I didn't want to lose it anywhere, so I want to make sure I give it to you. Don't just conduct exit interviews, conduct stay interviews. And that's with your internal team, and that's also with your customers, right? So with the customers, that's the QBRs, quarterly business reviews. That's a very formal process. That's not a, hey, how are we doing? How would you rank us? It's sitting down and having a really deep discussion, and the same with the employees. So I just wanted to give you that tip if you're not doing that now. Okay, so let's talk about really good questions. And you guys might want to screen capture this, take a picture of it, something. These are really good questions that I consider relationship changing that you can ask customers. So the first one is, how have our temporary associates impacted your business? Wow, that's a good question right there. Tell me about the productivity level of Tom instead of how's Tom doing, right? Tell me about the productivity level, or how is he meeting or exceeding your expectations? Another great question is, what area of your job is impacted by our relationship and how is it impacted? If I can make the working relationship easier, why don't I, right? So that's what's going to keep somebody loyal. You're interested in me. We're going to go back to what you guys said, right? They had a personal connection. They treated me as a person. Same thing here. What can we do to reduce that workload for you? How can we work better? Sometimes when we have been in a client and they've been our client for so long, we turn on autopilot and we say, oh, we need to turn off autopilot and start asking some really good questions. What value do you see that we add to your organization? These are what I call you guys high return questions. I'm not leading them down any path. I'm opening up for a huge conversation that could go in a variety of ways, which is what we want, right? If you owned a staffing company, what would you do differently than what you have experienced? Not what would you do differently than what we're doing, right? They're gonna feel like, oh, I don't wanna hurt their feelings. It's then you've experienced. What's the one thing we should never stop doing? Because by golly, if we're doing something good, we ought to keep doing it, right? And when you're working with us, what's the biggest hurdle? So out of curiosity in chat, I would love for you guys to type in for me. Do you use any of these questions? Have you used these type of questions before? So if you'll type in chat, if some of these are yes, I have, or no, I haven't, one or two, I will say, while you're doing that, I will say there are a couple that are my favorite. Mine is, how have our temporary associates impacted your business? Because I think that helps me write a great success story for future prospects and future sales. And I also love the one about the staffing company, right? What can we do? What would you do differently than what we're doing now? These are going to help you determine, what are the hot buttons? What's the real value without leading them down a path that we normally go down? They may take us down a totally different path because we are in a totally different workforce environment. So that's for your clients, but what about your internal team? What kind of questions can we ask them? So here's a group of questions that I like to ask How has this position impacted your career and future growth? You better believe every young person I talk to, they are never talking to me about, I see myself at this company doing this in 3 years. They talk about, this is where I want to be in 3 years, and if it means I have to leave to go here to be there, so be it. So we need to know, how are we impacting or what are we offering to them? Okay, good. So Carrie, I have to process your chat for a minute, but good. As long as we think about the wording, I think that's important. What's the best thing that's happened to you at work in the last 30 days? I'm leaving this open because it could be, well, I went out and had some drinks with the coworkers and we had great laughs after work. Or it could be, I made a great placement. Or it could be, I learned a new skill, right? We're leaving it open-ended so they can put in whatever they want. What area of your job can we provide additional guidance and support? People always want to learn and grow, and they don't want to be stagnant. So how can we help them do that? Same thing, if you owned a staffing company, what would you do different for your internal employees? What's the one thing we should never stop doing? Again, right? If I'm doing something great for the internal employees, I want to make sure I keep doing it. But this last one I think is interesting. Compared to other companies' employee experience, where do we exceed and where do we fall short? So think about that for a minute, you guys. Your internal team, they're out with their employees. They're out with their friends and they're chatting about work. And they're hearing their friends say, oh my gosh, guess what our company started doing? They've given us all free podcasts or whatever. They've done this new thing, or they're taking us all through this new training journey, whatever. What are they hearing from their friends, from their employees that might be good for us to consider? And my two favorite are the ones I've highlighted here. I think those will give us some really good information. The bottom one especially, because if I say it once, I'll say it 1,000 times today, the workplace is changing so much that there might be some great new ideas out there that we aren't aware of, and asking, what are your friends seeing, right? What are your relatives seeing? What are your family members seeing? That can give us a lot of great input. So we've talked about, we have to measure, we have to ask the right questions, but how do we ask them? How do we gather that feedback? For the best feedback, you guys, you have to gather it in a variety of ways. So let's talk about what that looks like. What is happening here? And because I'm not animated, I'm kind of giving it away, but when you see this picture, what comes to mind? And in chat, if you will, tell me, was it lazy? Was it I'm avoiding something? Was it just funny? I mean, if I drove down the street and saw this, I would chuckle. It would be sad, but I would chuckle. Totally lazy. Or maybe they're ignoring the problem, right? If this, being in Atlanta, like if I'm in South Georgia, if I'm out in a rural area, and I'm the one painting the line, maybe I'm thinking, oh, it's a big deal. Nobody's going to see this anyway. I'm just going around the tree, right? It's too much of a hassle to get out and move that limb and do it correctly. I'm just going to go around it. I'm not going to address it. However, this is a great analogy for what could be happening in your company. Are there areas that you're losing employee loyalty and you're not addressing it? You're going around it. You're avoiding it. Maybe you know something's going on and it's just overwhelming to kind of to jump in and handle it. However, if you have an employee that's in the tolerance or the decision phase, and this is how you handle something that's important to them, they're out the door, right? So this is very humorous, but it also is such a great way and a good reminder of, we need to put in the extra effort. We need to make sure we find out what we need to find out and address issues and challenges as they arise. So how can we gather this data? Right, this can seem a bit overwhelming. How do we gather it? Well, you know, we have the informal methods, right? You walk by somebody's desk and they just made a great placement, and it's like, that's fantastic, congratulations. What do you think set you over the top? What do you think made you get that extra step and get that placement? Or maybe you walk by a desk and say, is everything okay today? You seem like you're not quite yourself today. Is everything okay? That's informal. But formal methods are where we can really gather and analyze our data. So we suggest when you are trying to determine the loyalty and what kind of loyalty, how to earn it, what's expected, what do your clients or what do your employees value, right? When they leave at the end of the day, emotionally, they've invested so much, what do they go home with? In order to figure that out, we suggest breaking your entire company into teams. So create a set of questions for your recruiting, sales, management, and back office. They will all have a set of the same questions, but there might be questions you'd ask the recruiting team that you might not ask your sales team, and vice versa. So we think it's important that you break them out like that. Then what you need to do is within each of those teams, do an online survey, an anonymous online survey. SurveyMonkey, any of those, right? Do a survey asking the specific questions. I've given you some. I'm sure you guys have others you use regularly. If you're a best of staffing, you might have some good questions that you ask. If you're best of staffing client or talent, either one, right? You might already have some good questions, but you'd have additional too. So do that formal survey first. Then do a focus group and follow up on what you got out of the survey. That focus group, you guys, can be done in a variety of ways. It could be in person. Hey, let's get pizza, sit around the table, let's have a chat, right? Just open up, let's talk about. You could also do it via Zoom. And you could have an anonymous Google Doc. And as you ask questions and they're giving suggestions, they could be putting them anonymously into a Google Doc. And that way you would be able to keep everything in one place, but you wouldn't know who was saying what. So they might be more open, right? So if you ask these questions, I want to make sure that you just have a formal way to gather that feedback. That's very important. But I get the feedback. Okay, so I've done the survey. I've done focus group. What do I do now? Now, you guys, there is nothing worse than being asked, hey, what can we do to improve things? What do you think would really help us improve this being a great work environment? What should we do? And then I tell you, and you don't do anything with it. There's nothing worse than that. So if you're gathering feedback, you have to take the step of investigating what were all the suggestions given, what were the solutions provided, and you have to take action on those. I'll give you guys an example. I had a client who stressed the importance of having these annual surveys that went out to the whole company. They sent them out to everybody. They combined them by branch. And the owner of the company would go to each branch and he would discuss what came up in the survey to get more feedback. Kind of similar to what I said, right? The survey and then the focus group. But what happened was the manager or the owner goes out. They think this is great. This is fantastic. He's listening to us. Nothing ever happened. So people quit responding to the surveys and nothing ever came about. So if you do gather this feedback, make sure that you take it the next step. Because my favorite saying, no change equals no change. My favorite saying. So when you get this feedback, I want you guys to think about this. Take each item that they've given you as feedback, what they consider the value that you're giving them, what they consider important, what are their needs, each one of those and categorize them. And you might even do this actually before you do the survey, you might categorize them during the survey, but what's technology related? You know, do they know of some great technology out there that should be utilized? What's benefit related? And then what is training related or anything else, right? Compartmentalize them and then understand how and why each item provides value. So if they say to you, I'm going to use a really old example here just because it's the first one that came to mind. You know, we want a ping pong table, right? Well, okay. So what would you get if we had that ping pong table? What value would that provide to you? You know, it might be, I need a stress reliever because after making 100 phone calls, we all need to step away and take a breath. And if I can play ping pong for 10 minutes and then go back to my job, I can be more effective. The value is going to be a stress reliever, whatever, right? We have to understand the value. Create action items for each item. That could be, you know, a suggestion we had was we needed to take everybody to Cancun as a company retreat. Well, we can't afford taking everyone to Cancun. So the action for that item would be, thanks for the great suggestion, but we can't afford that. That's financially not something we can do. Or send somebody off to research it, send somebody off to gather more information about it. If you have employees that give you these suggestions, have them be the ones that do the research because they're going to buy into it, right? They're going to put more energy into it. And always ask what you're missing. Okay, we've done all of this. What is there anything we're missing? So when we investigate, remember, if we investigate and don't go further, no change equals no change. You guys are going to be back here trying to get internal to having this. Right now, my clients are telling me, you can say in chat, yes or no. Not only are they having trouble finding temporary employees, they're struggling with internal turnover. Some companies are up to 40% internal turnover. You're going to continue to see that unless we figure out how can we get them to stay. What will keep them here? Once we gather all of that, we can actually know what is the value, what is the benefit, what do our clients, our employees want to stay here? What's going to make them loyal? When you have that, you can actually create a value proposition statement for your internal employees. Now, this is something that's a little bit different. So let me tell you what this is, and then I want to hear in chat if you have one of these or not. An employee value proposition statement is similar to one that you would have for a client, right? Which hopefully everyone does for sales. You have a value prop. But this is from, Indeed did such a great job with this. I'm just giving you Indeed's definition because it's really good. Employee value proposition sets you apart from your competition, and they can help you attract quality candidates and retain those impressive employees. But it involves learning what your current employees enjoy about your company, about what they do, and what candidates want in their ideal workplace. So once I learn that, which is what I just told you guys, right? Once you can figure out why do they enjoy your company? What do they get out of working for you? What is their ideal workplace to a degree that we can give to them? That allows you to craft this EVP. And it's a statement that basically, it can include benefits, right? Financial rewards, career development, perks, that kind of thing. It's not all about the company. It's about the employee also. So I would just love in chat for you guys to tell me, do you have an employee value proposition statement? Yes or no? So if you will chat that in for me, do you have an employee value proposition statement? Yes or no? So I'm going to go back and reference all of the statistics, the trends that I showed at the beginning of our session. I really do feel very strongly that you need to start working towards crafting one of these. This isn't something that you're going to be able to go home tonight and write, right? That's the reason I'm giving you the steps for the magic. But I want you all to craft one of these. So when you are recruiting, when you're job posting, when you're talking to your internal team, you have this value proposition statement that drives who you are and what you're giving to your employees. So to craft the statement, as I said, it really needs to be focused on the employees, not just you. What is the employee going to get out of it? Please be honest. Don't just make something up because it sounds good. Use what you gathered from the questions and the surveys to create the statement. And, you know, make it fun. Make this something that you want to do with the company before the end of the year and get everybody involved, right? But what should happen is it should answer the question, why should I invest my time here, right? Why should I work for you? That's the question it should answer. Most employees want to feel like they are contributing something to society. So remember, what do the employees' actions contribute to society or to your company or to the temporary associates, right? They're putting food on people's tables if they don't understand that. And you have to figure out by asking and gathering information, what engages your employees? What gets them jazzed to come to work every day, right? So I want to give you a couple examples to kind of give you a start here. So one is we embrace diversity in thought and encourage our team to be creative when engaging with temporary associates and our clients. We focus on helping both the clients be successful in their goals, both of our clients, meaning clients and temporary associates, to be successful in their goals, their needs, and their future. So that's one EVP as an example. This next one came from Bain & Company, and I thought it was so good, I wanted to share it with you all. Picture yourself at one of the world's best places to work, surrounded by teams and people who challenge you, who support you, and inspire you to be extraordinary. That's a great EVP. On the right, I've just put some taglines from some well-known companies that are pulled from their EVPs, just so you have an idea of some other thoughts of what it might look like. But your EVP needs to be specific to your company. So in wrapping up, what I want you to think about, and I asked you this at the beginning, what makes your customers and your internal employees loyal to you? What would make your customers run to you? What would make your internal employees run to work every day? Because they're loyal. And the way you can figure that out is using the MAGIC acronym, right? Measure what's happening today. Ask the right questions to measure where they want to be. Gather that information, investigate it, take action on it, and then create that value proposition statement. That will help you stay focused and keep you focused on what's valuable to your employees. And you guys can do the same thing for your clients as well. To me, clients are as important right now as your employees, because again, what have I said all along? The workplace is different, and I'm sure your clients have a different set of values and a different set of requirements and different thoughts than they did back in the middle of 2020. So it's your choice. Right now, based on the workforce trends and where we're headed, you can choose to come together as a team. You can choose to figure out where your employees and clients are in the relationship chart. If they're in tolerance or decision, you can make that choice to come together and figure out what's the value, what's going to keep you engaged, what's going to keep you loyal, or you can make the choice to come apart. If somebody is in tolerance or decision, just know that they're going to be walking out the door. So it is your choice at this point in time. And I hope you'll choose MAGIC. On that note, I would love to open up the floor for any questions that you might have. So if you guys want to ask questions in the chat, I would love to answer any questions that you might have. Questions, comments, any of those. And Amanda, I'm not looking if there's a Q&A panel. I'm not looking at that either. So if somebody added something there. Any questions?
I'm not seeing any questions come in the Q&A.
Okay.
As people are thinking here, what is one of the biggest questions that you seem to get in relation to the steps it may take to implement magic within your organization?
So what was the biggest challenge with it, are you saying? Was that your question?
Yeah, of,
okay.
Right, of getting that implemented.
Okay, there's two pieces to that, and that's a great question. The first piece is taking the first step, right? I have something right over my computer on my wall, and I look at it every day, and it says, take action. An inch of movement will bring you closer to your goals than a mile of intention. And that first step is critical. The second step that's the biggest challenge is the facilitation of the surveys and the focus groups. The person facilitating does not need to be the owner or a senior manager. The person facilitating needs to be a middle ground employee, if you will. I know some of my clients have me do that because I'm an outside person and I have no prejudgments about anything, right? I can just come in and facilitate these focus groups. That is the second challenge, is who's going to do the survey, who's going to facilitate the discussion, and then organize it and pull it together. Because right now, today, we're all strapped for time, right? Speaking of that, thank you all for giving me your time today, because I know we are strapped for time.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. So Amy's contact information is here on the screen. Again, if you'd like a copy of today's PowerPoint presentation, please go ahead and send her an email, and she'd be happy to share that with you, or contact her offline if you have any specific questions that you may want to chat with her about directly. And with that, I know we're coming up on the end of our time today. So Amy, thank you so much for covering this valuable information.
Sure.
and allowing us to think a little bit differently about how we can come together, both with our clients and our employees. So with that, I will close out today's presentation and thank you all for joining us and sharing your feedback in the chat session today. It's very helpful to have that two-way communication. So thank you for doing that. And I hope you all have a really wonderful afternoon, and we'll catch you in our next webinar session.
Thank you all. Have a great day.